In order to evolve strategies with a genetic algorithm, we need to encode them in such a way that the genetic algorithm can deal with them. So here's how this works. So remember, here's our example of a strategy with all possible situations represented and an action given for each possible situation. What we can do now is just take the list of actions and remember the order of the possible 243 situations. So now we can cut off this list of actions and remember that the first action corresponds to the first situation, which is everything empty. The second action corresponds to the second situation, which is everything empty except for a can in the current site, and so on. So now we can take just that list of actions and we can encode it according to a numerical code. So what I'm going to do is give each action a number that is its code number, 0 through 6. Then I can encode this particular strategy by substituting the code number for each of the actions in the list. So now a 0 here in this first position means that the very first situation, that is all empty, corresponds to the action move north. A 6 here means that the third situation, whatever that was in our ordered list, corresponds to the action move random, and so on. And this way, we now have a list of numbers that represents a specific strategy. When Robby goes to perform an action, he looks around at his situation. He remembers the ordering of possible situations, and he says, oh, I'm in situation, let's say, 201. Then he looks for the 201st entry on this list, figures out what the code corresponds to in terms of an action, and performs that action. And then he does that again and again and again. So that's how we're going to encode a strategy. So you can think of this strategy very, in a kind of metaphorical sense, as Robby's DNA. This is what's going to evolve, is this list of numbers. And of course, this list of numbers has 243 values. So if you want to think of each one of these numbers as a particular gene, you can say that Robby has 243 genes. Of course, the analogy with genetics is not meant to be exact. It's only meant to be sort of a very rough conceptual one. Okay, so now here's a question. How many possible strategies are there given this representation? We'd like to find a good strategy, but the question is how many would we have to sort through in order to find a good one? Well, we can ask how many possible ones are there? Well, if we look at 243 different positions, and in each position there could be 7 possible actions, since we have the numbers 0 through 6 that could go here. So the total number of possible strategies is 7 times 7 times 7 for each possible number we could put in each position, 243 times. So the answer is a stunning 7 raised to the 243 power, which is one of those astronomical numbers that you could never hope to get through in your lifetime, or even the lifetime of the whole universe. This is an impossible number. Nobody could possibly search through all these possible strategies. And the goal here is to have a genetic algorithm search intelligently in this vast space for a good strategy. Now we're finally ready to figure out how to use a genetic algorithm to evolve strategies. So the first thing that we're going to do is to generate 200 random strategies. The number 200 is just arbitrary. I just picked it here. But some number of completely random strategies. That's going to be our starting population of strategies. So here's just a list. I ran this. When I run the GA, I generate 200 individuals, where each individual is a strategy. It's this sequence of 243 numbers, where each number is between 0 and 6. So you can just see they look kind of random, hopefully, because they are. Okay, so now we're going to calculate the fitness of each strategy by having Robby use that strategy to perform a bunch of actions in his world, which is filled with empty soda cans. And what I'm going to call An environment is a particular configuration of empty soda cans in his world. When we start out, we can just put empty soda cans at random places. Then we let Robby obey a particular strategy for a certain number of actions that he can perform. We calculate his reward minus his penalties. And then we do it again for a different environment, that is a different configuration of cans. We do this many times, and the fitness of the particular strategy is the average reward minus penalties over all those different environments. At this point, we've calculated the fitness separately for 200 different strategies, and now's the mating part, where they pair up and create offspring via sexual recombination, of course, in quotations here, because they're strings of numbers on a computer, with random mutations. The fitter the parents, the more offspring they create. So what we do is we pick two fit parents. We pick them probabilistically, with the fitter ones being more likely to be chosen. Now I'm going to create an offspring by choosing some point here in the strings to split them. And the offspring, the child, is going to get this first part from its parent one and the second part from its parent two. Okay, so I make the child just by copying part of the parent one and part of parent two to create the child. And then the child can be randomly mutated by choosing a few random positions and changing those to random numbers between 0 and 6. So we just randomly change some numbers. And now we have our child. And we keep doing this again and again until we have a new generation of offspring. The old generation completely dies out, and then we start again at step two with the new generation. And we do this for many generations until we're happy with the strategy that the GA has found, or until we're sick of running it and we quit. I wanted to point out that the maximum possible fitness of a strategy is about 500. That's because there's 100 squares total in Robby's world. And each time Robby starts out in an environment, there's about 50 cans. That is, about half the sites have cans on them. Sometimes it's less than 50, sometimes it's more than 50 because of the randomness, but on average it's 50. And each can is worth 10 points. And so therefore, the maximum number of points that Robby can get in an environment is about 500. So before I ran the GA, I came up with my own hand-designed strategy, which was the simplest reasonable strategy I could think of. Here it is. If there's a can in the current site, pick it up. Otherwise, if there's a can in one of the adjacent sites, move to that site. Otherwise, choose a random direction to move in. So I implemented that strategy as a string of 243 values. Or I wrote a program to do that. Then I let Robby use that strategy to collect cans in a number of different environments, and I took his average score over a number of different environments, and the average fitness was 346 out of about 500 max possible. Okay, so not too bad. But then I implemented the genetic algorithm and ran the genetic algorithm, just as I explained to you, and found that its average fitness of the average fitness of the best evolved strategy was 486. Almost perfect. So the question was, why is the genetic algorithm doing so much better than I am? What is its strategy doing that is so much better? This turns out to be a non-trivial question to answer. I know the logic behind my strategy, but the genetic algorithm, at the end of its run, spits out a string of 243 numbers and says, here's my strategy. This one works well. It has a high fitness. But it's hard for us to see exactly how it works. It's kind of analogous to the human genome. You know that the human genome was sequenced. We know what the sequence is, but there's a big jump from knowing what the sequence is to knowing how it works, what the functionality is, how the different genes give rise to different functions. So to look at the genetic algorithm strategy, I first plotted for a run of the genetic algorithm. I plotted the best fitness in the population as a function of generation. So as time goes up, let's see how the fitness of the best individual in the population are improving. This is the version I implemented in the programming language of C. You are going to be able to play with a version I implemented in NetLogo in a little while. But that one actually is relatively slow, so I ran the C version to get these results. So you can see that at the very first generation, the fitness is very low. It's below zero, so it's negative. We'll see why in a minute. But very quickly, the best individual in the population starts having higher and higher fitness. And you know that at each generation, the whole population turns over, so these individuals are different at each generation. And the fitness stays about the same for a little while here, and then it takes a steep jump, and a steep jump until it reaches another plateau, takes another jump, another plateau. All these little variations up here are because the fitness function itself has some randomness in it, because we're randomly generating the cans. The cans aren't always the same number. And the layout of cans varies from environment to environment. So you get different fitnesses even for the same individual at different generations because they're being tried out on different can configurations.